Good morning and welcome to our service. January 24th is the final day to sign up for the marriage retreat at Camp Roxbury in Orrsville, PA. You can register on the church website or contact the church office. Our theme for the weekend is We Greater Than Me. The retreat will be held Friday, February 5th through the 7th. The cost is $150.
We are excited to restart our Wednesday night family program this week from 7 to 8 p.m. This is open to all kids grade 5 and under, and all kids will need to be accompanied by an adult. It doesn't have to be a parent, any adult is fine. We would ask that you please wear a mask and you bring a water bottle for each person. We will be serving snack, but we will not be offering drinks. We would appreciate if you would pre-register before your family comes. You can do that by logging on to the church webpage and clicking on the kids button. This helps us to know how many families to prepare for. We are also going to move to a new location this time, so if you would like to come, please come to the multi-purpose room. That's on the first floor, it's the old sanctuary. You can enter using the main entrance or you can enter using the State Street entrance. We'll no longer be meeting in the basement.
We have many ministry and fellowship opportunities for you and your family in the months ahead. Our youth fundraiser, Soups and Sweets, will be held on February the 14th. This is a carryout only. We are thrilled to offer our family fun night at the park, as well as the annual Pinewood Derby race once again. It is our intention to hold a baptism service in March and welcome Dr. Randy Smith to MGBC for a special series of sermons in the month of April. Dates and times for these and other important events are available on the Save the Date sheet located at the information desk. Be sure to pick one up today or go to the church website at mgbconline.com. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning.
Thanks for joining us here in the building. Thanks for joining us online. Thanks for joining us if you're online watching randomly on Tuesday, because that's an option too. No matter where you are, what time it is, you're welcome. And if you're here, we're going to invite you to stand up. We're going to read our call to worship together this morning. This morning's message is coming from Ephesians 2. The songs are geared right around the same theme, and our call to worship is verses 8 through 10. So let's read together. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. I'm going to open this morning's service with the song Made Alive. We've been singing it the past couple of weeks, really in preparation for this week's message. The entire song is taken out of Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 10, which Pastor Brandt will be preaching from later. So as we sing this song to open the service, maybe you're familiar with the passage and you'll start to see some of those themes and concepts as we sing it. Or later as we go through the passage, maybe you'll see some of the things that we sang there later. So either way, let's lock in on what we're singing. Let's worship through song. Please sing along with us.
Amazing grace, every land. erased. I'll never be the same. My sin has been erased. Sing that again. My sin has been erased. I'll never be the same. My sin has been erased. I'll never be the same.
Let's sing this out.
Wow, so you're still wearing that shirt. Anyways.
Did you think I was going to change in between first sentences?
I would hope after. So, when you love someone, you call them out when you see wrong. I just see a decadence of pride, like right before me right now. And
it's possible it could be a good sermon illustration. But when you wait 25 years, you got to wear it while you can.
As I told you before, I'm a Detroit Lions fan.
And you may wait 40 years. I don't know.
That's a biblical number.
I will say this, so let me just add this.
Sure.
A lot of you have said that, you know, you're pulling for Buffalo, you're coming on this side now that the Steelers are out. You may have committed to a pathway of suffering. I'm just letting you know, it generally does not end well. So just, if you're going to walk down that pathway, it could be a tough one.
Well, pride before a fall, that's biblical.
That's true.
Biblical.
That's true.
But anyways, what I want to say to you, whether you're a first-time visitor or you've been here for a while, what are we about here at MGBC, our mission statement, something you want everything to just go through this whole motto is worship God and serve others. So just remind you, that's the mission statement of our church. We want all of our ministries, all of our opportunities to flow through the idea of worshiping God and serving others. And later on, Pastor Brian's going to have an announcement for you on how you can do both those things in worshiping God and serving others. And another thing we do to keep you informed of what's happening in the life of our church, we have digital updates, which go out twice a week through your email. So we just want you to be aware of what's taking place in our church on how we're worshiping God, how we're serving others, about those opportunities. So if you are not getting those digital updates, please contact the church office so that you can know what's happening within the life of your church family.
I know that many of you over the Christmas holiday took the opportunity to be involved in the connection that we have with those individuals that were isolated during the holidays, especially due to COVID. And many of you took these individuals and you sent cards, packages, things like that to them. We're going to continue to extend that. And there's a resource available out in the lobby. There's a table out there with a variety of different printed materials. So if you're sending a card or a note to someone or a package, you may want to take something off of that table. It's all free. And put it in the package that you're going to send or the letter that you're going to send out to them. We want to continue that. We want to continue to connect with those individuals
that have been isolated. And as Daryl pointed out, worship and serve others. This is a way that we worship God and we serve others, and through connecting with those individuals. And again, everything out there is free. If you did not have the opportunity to connect with someone, so you didn't have the opportunity over Christmas and you would like to take part, please contact the church office or see Danny Horton, and he can get you assigned to a person that you can regularly and consistently just bring encouragement and cheer to them in their lives. Before we go to the Lord in prayer, we do want to remember today is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday, and there are cards out in the lobby for Precious Life, which is a local anti-abortion agency, and so if you would like to take one of those cards, you're welcome to. Also, we want to pray for Pastor Brandt and the passing of his father this past week, for he and Claretta and the family. And also, let's join in prayer for a smooth and peaceful transition this week with the inauguration and transfer of presidency. So we do want to pray that things go smoothly and peacefully there. Would you join me, please? Father God, we come before you. We thank you and praise you for who you are, for your grace and mercy. Father, as a nation that has committed a grievous sin against you in abortion and the killing of millions of unborn life that you have created, we repent and we ask your forgiveness, Father. We just also would lift up Pastor Brandt and his family this week in the passing of his father. I had the opportunity to go to the graveside service, and we just rejoice in the fact that he is with you. And Lord, this week, as again we bring in a new president, we just pray that there will be peace. There's so much in our world and so much in our nation right now that is causing strife and division. I just pray that calm heads will prevail, and that you will provide peace, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we give this prayer to you this morning. We worship you, we honor you, we give you the praise and glory that you deserve. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Please stand as we continue to worship through singing. As we already mentioned, today's message is coming from Ephesians 2, and towards the end of the passage, it says that it's by grace through faith that you've been saved. So we're saved only because of the grace of God. We could never provide salvation for ourselves. So the next couple songs that we're going to sing focus in on that free gift of grace, and I encourage you to really reflect on that in your own heart. If you are a follower of Christ, what does that mean to you, and how should we respond in worship? And if you don't know Christ, it's our prayer that you would consider the words of these songs, consider the words from the message later, and really take to heart the gift that God offers us. Let's continue to worship together.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
As we continue to sing, we're going to teach a new song this morning. It's called Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me. And it's a longer song title, but that's the theme of this whole song. Nothing good that we can do comes from us, but through Christ working through us. And each of these four verses is just packed full of gospel-centered truth. And I think as you learn a new song, you're probably more concerned with picking up the melody and learning how to sing the phrases and stuff than maybe catching the words the first time through. So before we sing, Mary's going to read the first verse for us just so we can really reflect on what we're about to sing, and then we'll teach you the song.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to his. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but Christ in me. Through Christ.
Let's pray. Not us, but Christ, live through us, motivate us, challenge us, change us, allow us to rest in you and your hope and your grace through faith. Thank you for our salvation. Thank you for what you did on the cross and that you rose again from the dead and that you provide us life. Help us to live life, not just get through life. We want to thank you for this time in your word, and we pray that you would just bless us now as we're encouraged from the book of Ephesians. Thank you for our church family. Thank you for how we can encourage one another. And in these difficult times, we trust you because we know you're faithful. We thank you for that. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. It is also time for the kids to go to children's worship. The older kids go with Miss Jerry on this side. The younger kids go with Miss Aaron on this side. Have a good time. And I just want to say, before I get started here, that I do really appreciate the support of the church family during this time for our family. I know my mom wanted me to communicate that to you, that all the love and support with the homegoing of my dad earlier this week. And I know the guys have been really supportive. We have a team, so they immediately said that if I wanted to pass off the baton to one of them to do the sermon today, that we could do that. But with a team approach, we have a couple weeks to kind of prepare. So I was already in the midst of it, and I felt like this sermon's perfect for this week. It fits perfectly with what we're going through as a family. So I wanted to be able to share that with you. But it is also nice to know I have these guys that I can call upon when we need help, and we do get along. We may have differences in sports teams. I should have black on since the Steeler fans are in mourning, but we want to thank the guys for their support as well. Today we want to continue our study from the book of Ephesians, the call of the church. Pastor Brian reminded us 2 weeks ago that our identity is in Christ, and we are spiritually blessed. God has chosen us, adopted us, redeemed us, and provided us with an inheritance in heaven. That's a mouthful. That's a lot of stuff. Due to this fact, we can face the challenges of this life. Then Pastor Dale reminded us last week, our identity and hope should rest in Christ. We rely on the promises of God. This causes us to rejoice. We can rejoice in these times, even though it's difficult in this troubled world. Today we see that the church is called out from among the dead. We are called out to life because of what Christ did for us. God wants us to know that he takes the tragedy of sin in our lives and he makes it something brand new, something totally brand new, something completely different, alive and well. Well, Benjamin Franklin famously said this, and I use this quote a lot. I'm sure I've used it before in a sermon. But Benjamin Franklin said, "In this world, nothing can be said to be certain except death and taxes." And that is so true, especially the taxes part. No, death is certain as well. And this week, that became evident for us as a family, the reality that life is short. We're reminded that this is only a temporary time for us on this side of heaven. And when life gets turned upside down, which it has been for all of us with all the stuff that's going on with the virus and just all the unrest in our land, all the troubles, the disunity, just everything. It's been a tough, tough 2020. And we knew when that ball dropped, it wasn't going to be perfect. You know, 2021 hasn't been stellar either, has it? But God is faithful. God is good. And we trust him during these times in our lives. As we dealt with our personal family tragedy in one way, you know, a loss of a loved one is always a tragic event in our lives. It's difficult, but Dad had been struggling for a couple weeks, and we knew over Christmas it was different, and we knew that it was very likely that he wouldn't recover. We weren't sure. We were hopeful, but it wasn't fun doing his graveside service on Wednesday, I can tell you that, but it was an honor to be able to share the gospel message with his friends. He had a lot of racing buddies, and so it was good to have a couple of them there. We have hope in Christ no matter what happens. And I can smile today, 4 days after my dad's funeral because of the hope I have that he's in heaven. He trusted Christ. He made things pretty simple in life, and he had that simple childlike faith as a child, and he was very certain that when he died, he would go to heaven because of his faith in Christ. Hebrews 9:27 came to mind this week. It is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes the judgment. Doesn't sound real encouraging, but that's actually a positive verse. It's appointed once to die, and then the judgment. And for us who are in Christ, that know Christ, the salvation by grace through faith, our judgment is positive because we're judged by the blood of Christ and the cross and his resurrection. So we're judged for eternal life. We receive eternal life. That's a wonderful, wonderful thing. Romans 5:12 says this, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all have sinned. Death is not something we enjoy talking about. It's not encouraging. It's terrible. But it is a reality of life that we all must face because of our sin. We were born in sin. We have the curse of sin. And I want to show you a picture that I received from my friend, Pastor Doug Sabin. He's used this many times before. This is not an encouraging picture. Now, there will be another one later that is more encouraging. But this is it. This is our life. We're in Adam. We're born in sin. We are condemned to die because of our sin. And some pastors today won't talk about the word hell. They won't mention that it's a real place. It is. It's a place of punishment and torment forever because we have a holy God and sin must be eradicated. God doesn't want anyone to go to hell. But it is a reality because of sin. And there is only one remedy. That is our Savior, Jesus Christ. So this is our plot in life. In Adam, we will all die. We try to dress up death. We try to make it look better than it is. We do that with some of our funeral customs. No matter how many flowers we put on the grave, it's still death. It's still not a pretty picture. I find it interesting that the Tiglion people in the Philippines try to do their best to dress up death. They take their loved one and they put their best clothes on their loved one. And then they take a chair and sit it on their porch or outside of their house, I guess. And they sit the body in this chair, all dressed up for many, many days. And many of the people put cigarettes in their mouth, a lit cigarette in the mouth of the deceased loved one. And I didn't put a picture up there because I don't think we really want to see that. But if you want to Google that, you can. All right. I mean, that's kind of crazy to us, isn't it? But every culture has different ways of dealing with and dressing up death to make us process it and work through it. And it's just not, there's no way to clean it up. No matter what we do, death hunts us down from the day we're born. We are born spiritually dead, separated from God, and we have the consequences of our sins. And Ephesians 2 talks about this predicament. A very familiar passage, but harsh reality, profound theology, profoundly personal, this passage is. But let's look at Ephesians chapter 2. As you turn in your Bibles to Ephesians 2 or look on the screen, here's what it says. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, notice that word, when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, that's Satan. Interesting word choice, especially appropriate for today. Satan is the king of the air. I find it interesting. Radio waves, light waves, all that. Satan is ruling over the air today. He has control of the internet and Wi-Fi, social media, how destructive it has been to our culture, all the negativity. We shouldn't be surprised by all of the things that are happening today. This is not surprising to Christians at all. Our goal is to be faithful to Christ, to share the gospel message, to be positive, to smile, to give hope, to rejoice in the midst of a dead world, a world that's dying. It's destined to hell. And that ought to grieve our hearts. And we ought to be fighting and passionate about the gospel more than anything else. But many Christians are fighting the wrong battles. And I didn't share this in the first service, but just is kind of on my mind at the moment. You know, we have troubled times. We're living in this time of death, spiritual death, and Satan is the ruler of this age. The spirit who is now work in those who are disobedient, he is now at work. Satan's working big time. All of us used to live among them one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. We all deserve hell. We all deserve punishment for our sin. It's not a pretty picture. We're completely dead in sin. We were completely part of Satan's scheme. We were spiritually dead. That means that we were in bondage. We were alienated from God. We're like a dead corpse, and there's no way to dress up the situation. We are in desperate need of a Savior. We need a Savior. This world needs the Savior. This world needs Jesus. Dr. Randy Smith makes this observation about Ephesians chapter 2 here. You were shackled in the dungeon of the dead, enslaved by a wicked prince that forced you to entertain him in the filthiness of the flesh. We struggled with our trespasses and sins, it says. That's two different concepts. Trespasses are when we go in the wrong direction from what God's will is, when we slip and fall from God's standard. That's what happens when we sin. We don't meet God's standard. We also sin, meaning we miss the mark. We miss the goal that God has set for us. He wants us to have a fulfilled life, an alive life, a spiritually alive life, but we've missed the mark because of our sin. We are like a hunter who shoots his bow or gun at the trophy buck, and the buck runs away unscathed. That's sin, when we miss the total target. We miss the mark, and we are in bad shape. We find ourselves in a dire situation because of our sin. We are separated from God just like Adam and Eve were separated from God in the garden when they sinned. Our relationship with the Father is severely injured. Notice I didn't say it was devastating. Yes, we're separated from God because of our sin, but God wants to remedy the situation. There is hope in the midst of this dire situation. Paul proclaims in Romans 7:24, "Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from the body of this death?" We need someone to save us, someone to rescue us. We deserve wrath and punishment, hell. But wait, there's a Savior on the horizon. You see, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 is a very powerful verse. We tend to focus on verses 8 and 9 because it's such a popular verse, and it's an awesome verse. For salvation is by grace through faith and not of ourselves. We can't boast. It's not from us. Absolutely. But the power of the verse, the main verb of the verse, comes here in chapter 4. And it has given us this gloomy picture for three verses that we're dead in our sins and our trespasses. And then God says this, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved." The main verb is he makes us alive. He takes dead lives, dead corpses of sin, and he makes them back alive again. The King James uses the word, he quickens us back to life. We're raised back up to life. What a beautiful, beautiful picture for us. What a wonderful challenge. What a wonderful encouragement to us. The circumstances have been completely reversed, changed around 100%. It's miraculous what God does in our lives. And make no mistake here, this is even more profound than we might even realize in the English translation. You see, in the Greek, they sometimes will change the word order around and put words in the emphatic position at the beginning. And I don't want to get too technical, but I want you to know that the scripture actually says it's stronger here than we might even realize. In fact, our modern translations, I think, miss it a little bit here. They just didn't translate it as literal as I would have desired. So I want to show you what it says in the Greek in the original. It puts the words "but God" together. You have this three verses of all this negativity, and then it says "but God," and it's very emphatic. But God. God changes the whole picture because he's rich in mercy. That means he doesn't give us what we deserve. We deserve punishment. We deserve hell. But he's merciful. And because of his great love for us, he shows us grace. That's giving us something we don't deserve. That's heaven. And it's all compelled because of his love for us. He loves us. Even though we sinned against him and walked away from his plan, he loves us. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive. He brought us back. He brought us back from the dead. God is in the business of bringing people back to life every day. That's what he's best at, bringing people back to life. He did it with his son, Jesus Christ, and he does it for anyone who believes in Jesus today. We were dead in the water, but God made us alive. We have come back to life, and God hasn't forgotten about us. He made us alive the day we came to Christ. We no longer walk that path of destruction that Adam walked. That earlier picture now has totally changed. I want to show you this picture now. This is what happens when we trust Christ. We were on the path to destruction, but the day we trusted Jesus Christ as our Savior, we have an entire shift in where we're walking and where we're headed. We're no longer headed to destruction. We're headed to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. He gives us a new present. He gives us hope. He gives us a new eternal life, a future life. But get this, he gives you a new past. Have you ever thought about this? He totally shifts your past because of the cross. All of your sin from the past, all of your guilt, all of your shame is put under the cross of Christ. You are alive, but we live defeated. Many Christians live defeated, weighed down from the past, depressed, burdened. It's horrible how we live. Now, I'm not saying we make a pass for all our past sin, but it is covered by Christ. It doesn't mean we live a carefree life now. Well, Christ covers everything, so I can just go out and sin and I can do whatever I want because Christ covered it on the cross. That's not the attitude we should have. The attitude is, since Christ gave us a new past and saved us and covered all of our sin, we ought to be motivated to love him for the rest of our days, to seek to live a righteous life. Doesn't mean we're not going to sin. It doesn't mean we aren't going to deal with the filth of this world and the temptations. But it means that Christ is in us. We're in association with him. And he helps us live the godly life. And we're able to confess those sins daily to him. And he forgives us. But we live a new life. We're alive. We're not dead any longer. What a wonderful promise. The cross and the resurrection changes everything. The blood of Christ changes everything. We were stone cold dead, but now we're vibrantly alive and well. We're restored to serve God all of our days, to celebrate what he has done. What a transformation. You know what we need right now? We need some good parties and celebrations after this time. I know some of you have some Super Bowl parties in a couple weeks. That's kind of a small party compared to the party we ought to have, that we're alive in Christ. We need to celebrate what Christ has done for us. We're living in gloomy times, and we can't allow this world to bring us down, to steal our joy and to take our spiritual joy away from us. We cannot allow that to happen. Christ is in the business of changing lives. He takes the worst sinner, he saves him by grace, and he makes him alive in Christ. 1 Corinthians 15:57 and Romans 7:25 has the same concept. It says this, "But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We live a victorious life in the midst of death because we have been saved through grace, not of ourselves, but it is the gift of God, our Savior." But you know, the big question today is, it's one thing to know the theology of Scripture, to know what it says in the book of Ephesians, but this passage is extremely personal. Because if we don't personalize this theological truth, it goes nowhere. We must believe it personally. We must trust Christ personally to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from our unrighteousness. It's called the good news, the gospel message. Are you willing to submit your life to Christ, to change your life, to change your present, to change your future, and to even change your past and your identity and how your life is even defined? God wants to free you from the past. He wants to empower you with life right now. He wants to give you a future hope of heaven. We as believers need this reminder just as much as the lost. We need to be preaching the gospel to ourselves every day. We forget the gospel in our own lives every day. That's why we struggle with depression and discouragement and anxiety and panic attacks. We have to preach the truth. We need a change in our thinking. Dr. Charles Stanley talked about that this morning in his one message as I was coming to church. I caught the very beginning of it. He said, we need to change our thinking. We need to change the way we think. It's a battle. We have to think positive. We have to think about what the Bible says about us. We put all this negative junk in our head all week. We have to turn the stuff off. We got to get away from the negativity of the world. If we begin preaching this positive message to others, it will be attractive to this world. Our world desperately needs a positive message, and we have it in our hands that we were dead and now we're alive in Christ, and he can change our lives completely. We were given an important place. Not only were we dead in our sins, and we were made alive, but we were given an important place. We were given heaven. Ephesians 6 through 10 talks about that. And I'd like to just read this passage right now. It says this in Ephesians 2, 6 through 9. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, through belief. And this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God. We can't save ourselves. There's nothing in us that's good enough to do anything. We need God. We need Christ to work through us. It's not of works. We cannot boast. We cannot boast. We rest in the finished work of Christ. We have been given an important place in heaven. John 14, verses 1 through 3 says this. I love this passage, and it sums this up really well. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. We have that hope, that place in heaven, that we will be one place. Jesus is coming soon. He's coming again. We can leave this world of pain and death and experience true joy in heaven. These thoughts should motivate us. And that has been a motivation on my heart this week. I've been thinking a lot more about heaven this week in a different way. They say it's one thing to lose a loved one, but when you lose a parent, it's a different experience. And I agree. One of the things that's really impacted me is that I know my dad is with his sister. She died. My Aunt Mary, I never knew her. I was only 2 when she died. She died of cancer, having her for her child, and she wanted to keep her child, so she had her baby, but then she wasn't able to have the cancer treated, and she passed away. And then my dad's brother, Russell, died he had an auto accident and lived for years after that, but was never the same, and he passed away, and now he's in heaven, and my dad's with them, and he's with my grandparents, and that gives me great hope to know where they are and that they're reunited together. And what is our challenge here on this side of heaven? It's verse 10 of Ephesians 2, which is sometimes forgotten, but this is a critical verse. It says this, for we are God's handiwork or workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Do you know what this word is actually talking about? It's referring to the fact that we were a poem or we're a piece of artwork that God is working on us, and a true artist never finishes the masterpiece. Understand, artists always want to do something more to their painting, that the painting is never totally complete. There's always more to do, and that's kind of what God's doing with you. You're not perfect yet. God's still working on you. It's a process. Life's a process. You're his handiwork, and he's working on you. He's crafting you. You're a beautiful artwork. You're a beautiful masterpiece in God's hands. He loves you greatly. He saved you from your sins if you trusted Christ. And we are now to work for him. We're to serve him, to do good works, and to tell others about this message of salvation. That is our calling. We have been given a tremendous gift to share. And Daryl shared this with me earlier this week. I thought this was really profound, and he always comes up with the profound things. But he said this, since we have been given a tremendous gift by God in our salvation by grace, we also have a great responsibility to use this gift properly and effectively. Let's not squander our lives on wasteful or foolish things. Let us serve the Lord wholeheartedly. When you have a gift, you have a responsibility. We have been given a huge gift by God. We have a responsibility to share it with others, to use it to serve others, to follow our motto as a church, worship God and serve others. That is our calling. And right during the first service, this wasn't planned. An illustration that I thought of was my dad with gifts. He was really funny because, you know, when you get older, what do you get your parents? You know, after a while, they have about everything they need, and they don't really care that much. And so it's hard sometimes knowing what to get Dad for Christmas. But every year, we would get him gifts, tools, or whatever. Last year, I gave him a pair of gloves, really warm gloves that I really like. So I got him a pair of gloves, and he's like, oh, I really need a good pair of gloves. I'm really glad you got these. Well, my mom was going through a few things just the other day downstairs. He has a shelf in the basement. Well, guess what? A lot of the Christmas gifts end up on this shelf down there. And they're gifts that he hasn't used. So Mom found my gloves from last year's Christmas sitting there with the labels on. They're brand new. So Mom said, you might as well take your dad's gloves and use them. I'm like, yeah, they're my favorite gloves. I might as well take them. You know, that's good because he's not going to use them. You know, that's just how he is. And my brother once, to prove his point, he took a gift my dad got him. The first year, he was like, oh, yeah, I really need this. Well, my brother decided, hey, he never used that, so give me that gift. He told Mom, give me that gift. He wrapped it up the next year and gave it to him. And Dad opens the gift, and he was all surprised, like, wow, I've always wanted one of these. It's like, you already have it. It was sitting on the shelf, and you never used it this year. That was my dad. You know, so we have a lot of fun memories. He was just a fun guy. But what a challenge. God's given us a gift. Are we just going to sit it on the shelf and not use it? We need to share our gifts with others, our talents, our abilities, our words, our encouragement. We all have a message that we can share with a miserable world that needs encouragement. We need to share our gifts. We need to be God's workmanship. We can be so thankful for what Christ has done for us. 1 Corinthians 15:58 says this about this idea. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that the Lord, your labor is not in vain. Knowing that in the Lord, your labor is not in vain. God sees. He knows, and he's working in our lives. And I want to show you this picture again. Just remember that you have a new present. You have a new future. You have a new past because of what Christ has done. And that motivates us to live and serve him with all of our hearts. We are alive no matter how negative the world becomes, no matter how discouraged or depressed we may become. We are ambassadors of Christ. We are given a new life, alive. We are alive and well. Let us be joyful and hopeful. Let us put a smile on our face. I can smile 4 days after my father's funeral because I know where he is and I have the hope of eternal life. Yes, we are alive and well. As Mary and Ryan come to lead us in our closing song, I couldn't help but think of another situation in Scripture where our father and son were interacting. We see that the son wants to go live his life. He wants to be alive by squandering everything. He wanted his inheritance early. He wanted to go party. He wanted to do the world thing. He wanted to just be popular. So he spent all his money on partying and while living, and he had all these friends until all the money dried up, and then he had nobody. And he ends up working for a farmer, feeding pigs, which was horrible for a Jewish person to do. But he was feeding pigs, the fig pogs, in the mush. And he comes to his senses and he realizes, I'm dead. My life is ruined. I might as well go back to be with my father and be his servant. And what do we see? We see the loving father waiting for his son. And he runs to the son, which was against cultural norms. He wasn't supposed to ever run in his robe. But he runs to his son because he loves his son. He wanted to make his son alive again. And he gave him a new present by giving him a party and a celebration. He gave him a new future. and he forgave him of his past. That's what the Father does for us. We need to celebrate. We need to have a party because we are alive in Christ. And I'm thankful for Luke 15, 24, where it says this. The Father says this. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. And they began to celebrate. Live as alive, not dead. Celebrate your life and your identity in Christ. Don't allow Satan to steal your joy. Don't give Satan a foothold. Don't give in to depression. Lift up your head. Live your life, a positive life, because you are a child of God, seated in the heavenly realm of God. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for the promise of your word, that we are children of God, seated in the heavenlies. We are an adopted child, a son or daughter of Christ. Thank you for the salvation by grace through faith that you have provided for us, for all who believe. And I pray for anyone who has not taken that step to see that shift in their life, that they need Christ to provide life. I pray that you'll prick their heart right now and help them see they must turn their life to Christ to make that transformation, because it's the best way to live, free of sin and guilt and shame. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Please stand and sing together. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your thank you so much for joining us this morning. Pull up that slide real quick, Mike. I wanted to draw your attention to the website. We have some follow-up resources if you'd like to follow up with some recap and some reflection questions from Pastor Brandt's message. That's there. Something we just added this week, calling it Worship Replay. It's all the songs from this morning's worship set, if you'd like to listen to them again, and some additional thoughts that tie in to this morning. If your kids went to Children's Church this morning, we have some activities that go along with their lesson, and then our weekly prayer list is on there too. So you can go to mgbconline.com/discipleship, or just go to the homepage and click on Discipleship Resources to follow up with this morning. Thanks for joining us. You're dismissed.